Sally Clark,
who's very good friends with Dr. Metzner,
to be able to introduce him. So please welcome Sally, who will introduce our speaker.
Can I just ask you one more thing?
As I was coming
do we
tonight,
have to stop at 9:30?
No, 9:15.
This man is just amazing, and what he has experienced and the wisdom that he holds. I first met Ralph at a class on prenatal psychology. I remember looking out the window, and there was this man standing in the garden with this most radiant look on his face. And I asked William Emerson, who is that? And he says, that's Ralph Metzner. And that was my first experience of you, Ralph. He was just radiant. Over the years, I have really had the chance to look at some of Ralph's teachings and read his books. And this man has not just explored consciousness, he's explored consciousness. He's gone all the way back to preconception, prenatal, going up to birth. He's gone into near-death experiences. And it's not like he reads in a book and then he says, oh yeah, I read this, this is the truth. He experiences it. He's so courageous because he goes into some of the mystery of those places that he writes about. It's not just an intellectual exploration, it's a real in-depth that, in my own experience, when I've touched some of those realms of mystery, they can be quite fearful. And I just can't emphasize enough his courageousness to do this for himself and the collective, that we can bring light onto some of this. And as he explored, using psychedelics or ayahuasca is not just the most beautiful thing you ever saw, there are some real gut-wrenching things to experience. Ralph was born in Germany. His father was German, his mother was English, and he lived there during World War II. While England and Germany were in war. So you can imagine the dynamic to handle with those kinds of issues between mother and father. Later, Ralph went to Harvard, and he collaborated with Timothy Leary and Richard Alpert in the studies of psychedelic drugs, and co-authored a book, Psychedelic Experience, which is an excellent book. He is a psychotherapist and a professor. He was a professor at CIIS, and he continues to write many, many, many books. And when you read his books, they touch you so deeply. I picked up one last night and started reading at 3 a.m., and he had a comment in the book about a message he got from his mother, and I went, oh, maybe I can get a message from my mother, and off I was, based on, you know, a couple paragraphs in his book. So it's not just a book where you experience reading about something, they're very engaging, and he's written many, many books. So, as I said, we're very fortunate to have a teacher in the highest possibilities here with us tonight. So with an open heart, Ralph, we embrace you and look forward to hearing what you have to teach us. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sally.
Very generous introduction. And thank you for inviting me here to Palo Alto. It's a bit of a haul for me to come down. My wife Kathy and I to come down from Sonoma, where we live. So we're actually staying overnight, so it's not such a long drive all the way back. And I'm happy to be here, and I will talk with some slides that I've prepared, and then we're going to have a discussion period, because so much of the interesting areas can come up if I can respond directly to the interest that you're expressing. So much of the images and quotes that I'll present are from one of my books that I call Mind Space and Time Stream, and that in itself encapsulates a key idea that I want to convey to you, that every state of consciousness that we experience has its own space and time. That's how different states of consciousness differ from one another. They differ in space and time. For example, very easy to think, I can have a dream in a dream, which is a state of consciousness, and you can visit your relative, your mother or your father, who lives thousands of miles away, and have a heart-to-heart talk with that person. And it doesn't take you any time to get there. It's as if time has been obliterated, and time is, it's a clear demonstration that time is subjective, according to the state of consciousness that you're in. And so is space. It doesn't cost anything, it doesn't take any time to traverse thousands of miles. You're as close as you feel, you could say, and we know that. We use the language of closeness and distance emotionally, meaning emotionally. You could be standing right in front of somebody and say, well, I'm not really close to this person. Isn't that interesting? So this is the way we think of time and space, and space-time, is specific to the state of consciousness that we're in. And we're all now in a state of consciousness. You knew that, right? We're in a state of consciousness. It's called the normal waking state. That's what it's called. It lasts from the time you woke up to the time you went to go to sleep tonight. And those are actually, that's a sort of a traditional Eastern Indian yogic approach to it, that there are these four ordinary states of consciousness, which I think is good to adopt. There are four ordinary states of consciousness that we cycle through all the time. And they're altered, meaning they're different from what there was the state of consciousness that you were in before. And so the four ordinary states are the waking state, this one that we're in, and the sleeping state. And we know now from studies of the EEG and other studies that actually during the sleep state, there are two different states, the dreaming sleep state and the non-dreaming sleep state. They have different EEGs and different. And then in Indian philosophy, they recognize a fourth state they call Turiya, which is kind of a meditative state. And you might say, in modern terms, people might say that's like the alpha wave state, where you're kind of relaxed and your brain is sort of just humming along, not doing anything, not computing, and you know, just being aware, not sleep, but aware, like that. So, all right. So this is by way of inspiration and teaching. It's one of my great teachers, Albert Hoffman, who discovered, not invented, but discovered LSD, psilocybin, one of the great mystic scientists. His biography is described mystic scientist. And he said this, what we call reality is the product of a reciprocal interaction between material and energetic signals being emitted from the external world and the conscious living self in the inner world of the human being. And right there, this is a fundamental different approach than conventional materialist science, because materialist science, the only real thing is external reality. The inner world is merely, we say, merely subjective, so it doesn't really count. Okay, so that's that one. Now, I already clicked that. Well, did I do the first one I did was, that was the Albert Hoffman, the William James. Albert Hoffman, That's the one I just talked about. Did we talk about that one?
No.
Okay, radical empiricism. William James said that. Very interesting concept. You know, we all believe, and we pay lip service to the fact, our science is empirical. That means it's based on observation. But what William James pointed out, and this is just, he wrote this over 100 years ago. Empirical sciences, as we know them, do not recognize the inner worlds. They consider the inner worlds not subject to science, not amenable to science, because it's, after all, it's just thoughts. It's just subjective, you see. And William James pointed out, no, empiricism has to do with where you get your data and what you do with the data, where you get them. So he says, radical empiricism, you would not admit into your construction any element that is not directly experienced, nor exclude from them any element that is directly experienced. And that's the big difference. See, that's why modern empirical science doesn't consider dreams amenable to scientific study, or drug-induced states of consciousness, or philosophical ideas, or philosophical musings, or visions, or mystical visions. Doesn't consider them amenable to science, merely subjective, they typically say. So we did that one, and now here's the third quote that I really like, from the Dalai Lama, bless his heart. If the scientific study of consciousness is ever to grow to full maturity, given that subjectivity is a primary element of consciousness, it will have to incorporate a fully developed and rigorous methodology of first-person empiricism. Very interesting concept, because again, the modern scientific worldview means it's a third-person empiricism. You can only study somebody else's experience. You can't study your own, because it will be merely subjective, you see. So those are my three guiding spirits. And I think you as also, because otherwise you wouldn't be in a gathering like this. And two additional quotes from William James. William James was really incredible. To think that he wrote these things like over 100 years ago in the 1890s, you know, and before the whole thing of behaviorism. And he studied parapsychology. He studied spirit possession. You know, all kinds of things that science to this day considers absolutely off the scale, you know. The mind is at every stage a theater of simultaneous possibility. Think about that. It's a really interesting statement. A theater, that's the idea of things are presenting, of simultaneous possibilities. And these come from two different passages of his, but it's almost like this is a very good consequence of that one. My experience is what I agree or choose to attend to. This is very interesting. Now, people might say, well, what if I'm being tortured? Obviously, I didn't choose to be tortured. But note, this would cover it. What do people do when they're being tortured and in jail? They tune out. They dissociate. It's not part of their experience. They disconnect. So it covers it. It's very interesting. You choose to attend to it, it becomes your experience. Now, things may still happen to you, but that's not the same as having an experience. So, I think of these as four primary strands of awareness. If you think the idea of a stream of consciousness, that was one of the ideas that William James had too, and the ancients had, and people like Heraclitus. You know, our experience is a constant stream. And like time is a time stream, you see, time stream. And it's actually useful, I think, to distinguish four different aspects, four sub-streams within the overall stream of our experience. One is kind of the mental stream, and ideas, thoughts, cognitive processes. Another one is visual images, plus sounds and smells and tastes and so forth. And modern brain sciences would probably lean to associating that with the idea stream, cognitive processes with the left hemisphere of the brain and the images and sort of sensory experiences on the right hemisphere of the brain, roughly speaking. So, and then there's a stream of emotions, affects, or feelings. Those are completely different. They're not thoughts, they're not images, they're feelings. That's something completely different. And then the fourth one you could say is body sensations, like tactile, kinesthetic, thermal. You have all kinds of tactile, not just touch, all kinds of vibration, movement. You can experience directly sensory experience, all kinds of different. Some people say there's 49 different sense modalities involving touch. Sense, not the five primary senses. So, but however that may be, it's a different, it's not emotions, and it's not visual images, and it's not ideas. Now the interesting thing is all those four strands of awareness can go together harmoniously, or they can be separate. And we can be aware of only one, or maybe two, and not the others. In fact, that's very commonly true. And in fact, a lot of psychotherapy consists in connecting those, in connecting when somebody has feelings, lots of ideas, but is not experiencing the feelings that are naturally associated with those ideas because of various things in their childhood or traumatic experience. That's one of the things trauma does. It disconnects us from different aspects of their experience. So people can say, oh yeah, I had this experience, you know, where I was, you know, all these things happened to me. It was no big deal, like that. In fact, that's a very common experience, and psychotherapists, although the psychotherapists will know, this is one of the things that happens in trauma. The different aspects of the experience in memory process can be remembered, and the emotions cannot be remembered. Or sometimes people can just remember the emotions and not what actually happened, what they actually saw or thought. They just have a weird sort of, or a weird body sensation, and they can no way to connect with it. So these are the kinds of things that therapists work with all the time. So it's a kind of a dissociation, a disconnect of these strands of awareness. And then you can see that for a more complete experience, you'd want to have all the different aspects of your experience in a kind of integrated way, so that your feelings are harmonic with, harmonized with, and appropriate with the thoughts that you're having and the perceptions that you're having. Okay, so this is just another idea, concept, an attempt of mine to sort of get at some way of defining or thinking about consciousness and what it means. See, consciousness means so many different things. One of the things it means is sort of awareness of context. So I've set up this table of certain functions that we have, and then the same function, but with a context. Now I'll take the first pair, perception and apperception. Apperception is a very interesting concept, not very well understood. It was actually the basis of, when I was at Harvard, I studied, one of my teachers was Henry Murray, and he was the inventor of a test called the thematic apperception test. In the thematic apperception test, you're given a picture. It's a sort of a black and white picture of some people doing something, like a man and a woman sort of standing there and holding them with gestures and having certain expressions on their face and doing certain things with their hands and being in certain postures and like that with each other. But there's no text. There's no text whatsoever. So the idea is that you're projecting, this is called a projection test, you're projecting into it what you think, you subjectively see, think, might be going on there. It was called, from the context of their gestures and their expression and so forth, like that. So that would be, you're perceiving it, but you're perceiving a greater context. And then you think about the difference between sympathy and empathy. Sympathy is a sort of an automatic reaction. It's actually an unconscious, instinctual reaction. Animals have it. Animals are sympathetic with one another. And it's like vibrating together, like sympathetic strings on a guitar or a stringed instrument vibrate together. Misery loves company is another expression of that same thing. Let's you and I sit together and have a nice try, have a good cry. We wouldn't call it nice, but we'd call it have a good cry if something sad happened to it. Empathy is a little different. Empathy involves a certain consciousness, a certain awareness, additional awareness. I sometimes use the example of, let's say, you're walking down the street and there's a hole in the sidewalk and there's a person, you know, in the hole, 10 feet down. And then one reaction would be you jump into the hole with the person. So then, you know, misery loves company. It's nice, the person has company and we'll have a nice cry together, whatever. It's better to be together than alone if you're unhappy. Empathy would be, oh, I see, you're in a hole. Let me go get a ladder. See, so empathy means you feel a little bit like the other person feels, but you don't identify completely with them. You maintain your distance, but enough, you connect. And empathy is what the Buddhists call compassion. See, compassion means, yes, you feel like the person, but it's not just like you go completely into it. And so that would also be a parallel distinction would be between knowledge or information and wisdom or understanding, you see. Think about the difference between knowledge and understanding. You can know something, a lot about something, but not have really much understanding about the things that you know a lot about, you see. That would be quite different, wouldn't it? And we think about the difference between a reaction and a response. Reaction is like, I touch a hot stove and I go, oh, ouch, like that. Response is like, I think about it. What do I want to do? What's the appropriate thing to do? Orientation is like that. Orientation is an instinct. Animals orient themselves. You know, hunting dogs and birds orient themselves. They follow inbuilt instincts. Plants orient themselves. Heliotropic plants orient themselves towards the sun. Attention involves a conscious choice. I'm attending. I'm looking. Consciously, intending. Expectation, impulse, desire, this is automatic, kind of unconscious reaction. Intention or interest is in many ways the key to all understanding of all states of consciousness. So I'm just trying to give you a sense of how it's possible that each of the qualities, the functions on the left side, then the same function, but you add awareness of a context. And you add an element of consciousness, all those like a sort of a cloud of associations around it, then you have something different. Habitual thinking, mindfulness thinking, mindful thinking. Dreaming and lucid dreaming. See, that's the idea, lucid dreaming is, oh, this is a dream and I know it's a dream. Is this a dream, for example? How do we know this isn't a dream? That's a practice that the people who are learning lucid dreaming practice themselves. Every now and again during the day, you should ask yourself, is this a dream? How do I know it isn't? So then hopefully that practice would carry over when you're actually dreaming, you see. Judgment, you know, tends to be automatic. It's like judgment is, I like it, I don't like it. Have you ever had that experience of talking to a child that you know, or a young person that you know, and they say about the film, or they say about somebody, yeah, I liked it. No, I didn't like it. You haven't actually learned anything about the film, or even about the person's reaction to the film. Like or dislike is a sort of a two-value judgment, or actually three values, positive, negative, and indifferent. I like it, you know, I'll approach it, I'll take it, I'll eat it, or whatever. I don't like it, I'll go away from it, I don't want it. And indifferent is like, I could care less. I couldn't care less. So that's just to get you thinking about that difference and what it really means to add consciousness to something. So, all right. So here's what I call a map of consciousness. So there are two dimensions of states of consciousness. that are sort of energetic. They don't really deal with anything, have anything to do with the content of the states of consciousness. But they have to do with two dimensions. One of them is the dimension of arousal, amount of energy. And the other one is whether it's positive or negative, pleasurable or painful. So the vertical spectrum arousal continuum goes from very high arousal, very high excitement, to a very low arousal, which is basically deep sleep, stage 3 and 4 sleep. And you go along in the middle thing, you have different EEG waves associated with that. Sort of in the, if you think of the middle line as being sort of halfway, so EEG alpha waves are found when the brain is sort of coasting along, not asleep and not doing anything, but sort of awake and functioning, humming. As soon as you start thinking about stuff then in a focused way, then you're no longer an alpha wave. And then, so I have the functional waking state, half, you know, a little bit up on the wakefulness continuum, and then anger, rage, fury are way up there. So then you have these two, is that readable then? These two lines, horizontal lines, is where that go all the way across depressants and drugs that bring you down on the arousal continuum. There would be depressants like alcohol, barbiturates, sedatives, and tranquilizers. Now, whether that's a positive or negative experience depends on where you are when you started, you see. Now, and the same way, if you go up on the arousal continuum, these are where you find the stimulants like caffeine, amphetamines, cocaine, and so forth. And again, whether that's a positive or negative experience depends on which part of the horizontal continuum you're on. If you're on the pleasurable part of the continuum and you go up, you know, up in terms of energy, it becomes more pleasurable. So you get excitement and then maybe even mania or hypomania and then euphoria and then peak experiences. Maybe orgasm would be a peak experience of high excitement and high pleasure. The drug ecstasy, MDMA, is sometimes associated with that kind of state of consciousness. On the other hand, you could also, if you go on the pleasurable continuum, if you go in the negative direction, low arousal, you have relaxation, a sort of easy, you know, you're not interested in doing anything, you're just sort of laying back, relaxing, not much energy to do anything. Can you read that okay? It's marijuana. It's like that. You don't really necessarily want to do anything. You're more into experiencing something. You feel pretty relaxed, not asleep, but you know, relaxed and pleasurable, tranquility. I think of and what in hypnosis is called hypnotherapy is called an absorptive trance, where you're completely absorbed in the experience. And then post-orgasm, see? Post-orgasm is very high excitement. Post-orgasm is sort of, if you think of it, the analogy would be, orgasm would be like a waterfall or a fountain, and post-orgasm would be like a still lake. You know, peaceful lake, very pleasure, very, very beautiful, very calm, no interest, no need to do anything. And there are drugs that kind of get at that. Oceanic bliss, sometimes it's called, oceanic bliss. Ketamine sometimes can go into that direction, so can GHB. Now, if you go over to the left side, you have similar, different energetic characteristics, but tends to be unpleasant. So anxiety, distress is activating, energetically activating. You run around anxiously doing stuff. You have a lot of energy, but it doesn't feel good. What's called agitation, vigilance, you're vigilant. And all the way to fear, panic, terror. Fear, panic, terror are high energy states in the sense of high negative energy states. Person in fear, panic, terror is running around and can do things with a lot of force and a lot of power, often with a lot of danger to other people, you see, and themselves. And basically it feels dysphoric. And schizophrenia would be an example of that. Schizophrenia, psychotic states like that, are high energy states. That's one of the characteristics. if they're not drugged out. Nowadays, of course, as soon as somebody even slightly disciplined, they give them drugs. But in former days, it was very clear. Schizophrenics can go for days without sleeping, you see. Because, and then that, of course, adds to the difficulties that they're having, sorting out all the different confusing stuff that's going on. And then on the lower left, you'd have low energy and unpleasantness. So sort of feel drowsy, but not relaxed, you know. You can't, and then tension, you feel tense. So there's no energy, there's no flee. So kind of the energy is kind of locked up. When you're feeling sick, it's sort of like that. Oh, I can't get out of bed, oh, I'm miserable, like that. And then exhaustion, you know. And then depression. Depression is like a very serious thing and can get extremely serious. You know? No energy to do anything and no interest in doing anything. Not even getting out of bed. And some people estimate that something like 40 to 50% of the American population, I don't know how it is in other countries, are self-identified as being depressed much of the time, taking antidepressant medication. So that already tells you something about the society, doesn't it? So, now, let me go on to this, what I call a heuristic model of altered states of consciousness. Heuristic means it's useful to think about. It doesn't really explain anything, but it's useful to use that as a framework. You don't necessarily have to explain something in order to understand it, you see. Understand it in its own terms. So a state of consciousness is defined by a division of time. So I have the timeline in the base. So in a state of consciousness, the baseline is the consensual state. That's the state that we're in right now. This is consensual state. It's the state where we have a consensus. This is a room. This is a lecture hall. This is that people are listening to this person giving a lecture, and you know, like that. It's all consensual. We all agreed on that. Now and then, there's a trigger. There's a trigger that sets the person into altered state. Now it might be taking a drug, or it might be taking a drink, or it might be having a fight with your partner, or it might be seeing a fight, or it might be being in a dangerous situation, or being in a high pleasurable situation where we're very excited, or a film, or something like that. So some kind of a trigger that triggers the alterations. The basic idea was that what in drug research was called the set and setting hypothesis, that all your states of consciousness are defined by the set and the setting. The set being the internal factors of intention and attitude and so forth, and the setting being the context and all that. Of those two, I now actually think this formula needs to be updated, and I have updated it, is because the set is more important than the setting, because the set determines the setting that you choose, you see. Because you have this set, you had the set to listen to this guy Metzner, listen to hear what he has to say, which I appreciate you doing, thank you. And so you come into the setting where this is being arranged. But in terms of the scientific understanding of it, it's useful to think about the internal factors and the external factors, that they really determine every state of consciousness that we're in anytime, not just drug states or altered states. And then the alterations during the state of consciousness, there could be alterations in thinking, in feeling, in perception, and those can happen. And those can happen without really much of, we can have changes in thinking, feeling, and perception without really being in an altered state. But then if you have a change in body image and sense of time and space, that's when people really start to say, oh, it's like when, who was it, the woman that went in Kansas, you know. Where?
We're not in Kansas.
Yeah, we're not in Kansas anymore. Things are really different around here. This is what people say, oh, this is really different. Time seems to be like completely different here. I'm having a million thoughts a minute. And body image feels different. I'm not in this normal body image anymore. Now I feel like a squid or like a turtle or something like that. Or like you or another person. Or the universe. cosmic consciousness, and sense of self. If those are different, so sense of time and space, body, and sense of self, you say, this is definitely an older state of consciousness. This is not normal, you say. Although I no longer like to use the word normal, because normal is a consensual definition. And what's normal in one culture may be not normal at all in a different culture. And different cultures and different times and periods, and different families and different subcultures even may accept as quite normal something that other cultures don't. So it's useful to distinguish the set, what comes before, the actual alterations in time and space, and then the consequences. What do you do with the altered state afterwards? See, William James talked about that. He said, in radical empiricism, we look at religious experience in his book, The Varieties of Religious Experience. He said, people have all these religious experiences, but we have to examine, like, do the religious experience really lead to a change in behavior? Do they lead to a long-lasting change in the traits? And psychologists distinguish between states and traits, you see. State is like the state of anxiety is how anxious you feel at any given moment. The trait of anxiety would be how anxious you tend to feel most of the time. And those can be separately measured. And it makes sense to do that. And so when people have an altered state of consciousness experience, they want to look at what went beforehand, what triggered it, and then what went afterwards, what did you do with it? Did you just dismiss it and say, oh, well, that was weird, you know? Oh, that was a really weird dream, or I took this drug and that was really weird. I don't think I'll take that one again. Oh yeah, that was really weird. I think I'll take it again as soon as possible. You get all those attitudes. But what did you really learn, you see? So anyway, those are the kinds of questions that I've spent a long time in thinking about and talking to people about and asking them about. So this is my basic formula. This is my equivalent of E equals MC squared. So the intention, any state of consciousness that you're in at any time, the intention leads to attention. And then the attention leads to, the arrow means leads to. It's like a vector, I think they call it in mathematics. It leads to awareness. Intention, your intention was to come and listen to me talk, and then the attention, you're paying attention. Again, it's a gift. In German, we say, schenk die Aufmerksamkeit, give the gift of attention. In English, we say, pay attention. It's interesting, isn't it? It's not just passively sitting there. You see, you could just passively sit there, but you're not. You're paying attention. It's just like a gift that you're giving me, which I appreciate. So now, that attention could be interrupted. Let's suppose that a naked woman, or a naked man for that matter, walked in the door. Our attention would definitely be redirected, or a loud noise. Then our attention would be redirected, and we would attend to that. And then we would maybe come back to our original intention after that. And then that determines what we become aware of. Now, if we're not paying attention, there may be all kinds of other things that are going on that we're not aware of. And so this is the key formula. So now, why is it intention or question? Because those are the two main modes. Attention is sort of like an arrow, it's like the hunting. And a question is like gathering. You know, when you're a hunter, you're very focused. You're looking for that rabbit or that deer. I remember watching my cat one day, you know, who was watching a bird through the window, which she couldn't get through the window anyway, but she was like, you know, like that, and her whiskers were going, and the back of her tail was going like that. And she's like this, completely focused. And now question is, because it's the hunter. The hunter sees the prey and focuses on the prey and focuses that way. Focus, aim. Question is different, it's like gathering. Now when you're gathering, let's say you're gathering herbs or fruits or the garden, you don't know where they're gonna be. So you have to look around. You have to look this way. Circumspection, all everywhere. Mushrooms, I say, hunting mushrooms. Not targeted, you see. So we always have those two ways of deploying our attention. And we want that deploying of attention to be conscious and intentional. Because it can be captured, our attention can be captured. As we say, captivating by a stimulus that's very intense or very attractive. We even say that, that's a captivating person or, you know, like that. And then that's what we become aware of. Okay, so. In my ongoing attempt to use diagrams to portray things in two-dimensional that are really actually happening in multi-dimensional or at least three-dimensional, you can think of awareness as a kind of a circle in order to model it, but actually it's a kind of a sphere, isn't it? Because we're kind of aware, our energy field is spherical all around us, and we're sort of aware that energy field is an awareness field. So you're sort of aware, you're aware of what's happening behind you, and you may be aware, sometimes in my talks I've asked people to tune into the person behind them, or you might get a sense of it. Even Rupert Sheldrick and others, has, they've done all kinds of studies about seeing without the eyes, you see, sensing. Like when you go in an elevator, in a crowded elevator, have you ever noticed, everybody is like this. You know, has their energy field like their wings sort of tucked in. Because it's sort of impolite, you're actually inside the other person. It's sort of intimate in a way. Because the field is just as much you as your body. But it goes through matter. So anyway, so when you expand, so normally in a baseline state of consciousness like this one, you can think of, so we're imagining a circle rather than a sphere, and out of that circle, like a 30-degree angle, it's like this is what you're attending to. Now, if we expand awareness, then that 30-degree angle might expand to 190 degrees that way. So that angle of perception would be expanded. Theoretically, it could be expanded to 360 degrees. Now, this is just an exercise in visualization. The baseline state of consciousness is the same, now contracted state. This is concentration. We call this concentration. Now, concentration is contraction of consciousness, intentional contraction of consciousness. It's called concentration. It's extremely important. Like if you were, and the two don't go together. It's very important to do the two things separately. If you're a scientist or a doctor or a physician looking through a microscope, you're concentrating on that, what you're seeing through that microscope. You don't want to be thinking about or looking at or admiring the sunset taking place outside the window, as you might be if you've taken a consciousness expanding drug or in your consciousness expanding mood when you're going for a walk, for example, like that. So normally in our everyday life, we go effortlessly and seamlessly go back and forth between concentration, concentrated state, focused state, for functional working state, for different purposes, you know, in profession, in family life, and everything, driving, all those things, to expanded states when we're relaxed and maybe after a beer or whatever, expanding drug, relaxing with the family, going for a walk, like that, expanded.
Can I ask you a question about your model here? So it's a circle, and you started with baseline state of consciousness. It looks like, does that mean that you're just conscious less than a quarter of what's going on?
Yeah, you're concentrating, you know.
I mean the baseline state.
The baseline state is just meaning the possibility. Yeah, the baseline state being the 30 degree. I'm assuming like the 30 degree kind of normal state. You know, we're sort of like, this is sort of like 30 degrees for me, you know. Like, it's sort of like, you know, that it could be larger. You know, and you could make it larger. For example, if you're going for a walk, you might expand. I like to do that and expand your awareness and, you know, the trees around you. And nowadays, what I see is people going for a walk and they're looking at their cell phones. I can't believe it.
Don't drive.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. That should be illegal to drive when you expand. And driving while drunk is not expanded consciousness. Drunk is even more contracted than the normal state. And so now there's another variation that's neither contracted nor expanded, but just different. same angle of arc of 30 degrees. Let's say this was a 30 degree angle. Same angle of degree, but differently. Looking at something else. That's called dissociation. Dissociation is a very interesting concept. Very poorly understood, by myself included. Not really talked about very much in psychology. It was until the late 19th century. People like William James and Wilhelm Wundt in Germany and other people in Germany talked about dissociation a lot, a great deal. And the associated states of consciousness are involved in trauma. Trauma, PTSD, is a classical dissociated state of consciousness. Extremely common, extremely common. Very poorly understood. But it can also be functional, in other words, intentional or functional. I'm going to concentrate on playing this piano concerto. I don't want to deal with the family at the issues at the moment. They say when the person is, I want to disconnect. I'm doing surgery here, I'm not going to deal with my marital problems like that. So, anyway, so going on. I wonder if I should go a little faster. Okay, so I'm going to just touch on this. This is what I call the Janus model. You know, Janus was the Roman deity that had two faces looking in two different directions. And he was, his image was put on coins, the coin of the realm. He was associated with the month of January, which is the winter solstice, midwinter. And the root of the word janitor. The janitor is the Romans said, Janus sits at heaven's gates and watches the gods and goddesses coming and going. So he's keeping track of who's going to Olympus and who's coming back from Olympus. So he's the deity that's in the present. In the present, we're looking into the past and the future. We always have the potential of looking into the past and the future. So when we're looking into the, if you think the present being the field of awareness and identity, this is who I am, this is who I am, where I am. This is what people now would call the personal life world. This is a concept from the phenomenological school, of European school of philosophy, philosophical psychology. And this approach, he gets through the, all the discussions that people have. Well, what is really the self? Is there really a self? Or does the self really exist? Nobody seems to be able to find it anywhere. But if you use the concept of life world, it's a relational concept. The self is not a thing, it's a relation. There isn't anything that you are that isn't relational. Like every one of you is a son or daughter of a man and a woman. You called your parents. That's a relation. You may also be the brother or sister. You have a husband or wife. You may also be a professional or something. That's a relation. There isn't anything that you are. In some languages, some native languages, there isn't such a word as to be. I couldn't say, I am a psychologist, let's say. I can't say that. I can only say, well, I have these relations with these people and these relationships with these activities and these places, relations with places and people. Anyway, so then there's this field of awareness, and then there are these two processes that we're involved in, and I'll just take the time to go into that in detail, but one is the process that we're mostly involved in when we're doing healing and therapy. We're regressing. We're moving from the present field of awareness into a memory image. There's an arrow going back into, I haven't moved the image on, sorry. Yeah. You're sending a stream of awareness into the past. We call it regression, retrieval, recollection. Is that a really good word? Recollecting a split off parts. And then you target a memory image. You have a memory image. And if it's been traumatic, then it tends to be dissociated. And then you remember. That's my favorite word in the English language. Remembering means the opposite of dismembering. It's reconnecting what has been disconnected. And then, see, the person who's healed a traumatic imagery, traumatic memory, a traumatic event, can say, well, this happened to me, and this really, affected me deeply, But now I have integrated this into my life, into who I am. For example, I was addicted to drugs, let's say, or alcohol, and I went through a healing. I defined myself as an alcoholic, and I went through a healing process and remembering who I truly am. And now I can say to myself, I'm a former alcoholic, which is very different, you see. Or I'm a former abuse survivor. So I'm no longer driving along, looking into the rearview mirror, afraid that the trauma from the past is going to suddenly catch up to me, which is what happens in PTSD. These poor soldiers, you know, that have been traumatized by their war experience, they don't want to have these flashbacks. They're having them unconsciously. They hear a sudden sound and they think they're back in the... They don't think, they react as if they're back in the trenches. And they may kill their family. That happens. You know it happens. So it's a double process. And then when you... the idea of the arrow coming back means you then integrate that. That's pointing to the fact somebody who's experienced trauma is different from somebody who's survived trauma. And that person can then say, I survived trauma. I had that trauma. I am no longer that person. I'm no longer dominated by that experience. Now I'm, you know, I am who I am, and it's an expansion of my sense of identity. Now, some exactly parallel process happens in relationship to the future. And there it's called a vision. You have a, we might call it a precognition, that's an older term, foresight, we call it foresight, presentiment. Actually, people think of it all the time. Intuition, in the business world, in the civic affairs, intuition is like all the time. I once asked a group of business people and in a seminar, you know, and other people as well, and psychologists, a lot of psychologists, like, psychologists spend a lot of time thinking about the past, you know, because you're always working through the traumas and your parents and all that. And so I asked people, well, how much of the time ordinarily in your business discussions with each other do you spend time thinking about the past versus the future? And they, what, you know what the business people say? They, well, I would say 90% of the time we're thinking about the future. We're not actually interested in the past at all. We don't care about what you did with your mother and your father. The only reason for going into the past is to see where did we go wrong in our last sales campaign. You know, our last sales campaign, we made this pitch and that didn't work out. So now we want to do it differently. And so we're anticipating, we have a vision. And that's the ancient tradition of a vision quest. People, the native traditions, people go out on a vision quest and they, you know, they pray to the spirits. They pray like, what's the vision for my life? And that may be the vision for my relationship, for my marriage, for my job, for my spiritual practice, for the world. And then of course, a similar double process. So you have the vision, you get the guidance, but then it's not enough just to have the vision, you have to make it real. Right? It's the little child who says, oh, a seven-year-old child, I'm going to be a doctor when I grow up. That's a vision. He got that vision. He wants to be a doctor. His father was a doctor. Like that. But then he has to go through the steps to make that real. See, go to school, go to medical school, da da da. And okay, so now let me go on to the next one. Oh, there's the Janus double image, and this is the personal life world with the one in the middle, the self system, spelled out more completely. The self is a system of relations with other human beings, with animals, plants, spirit beings, ancestors, deities, the physical deity. What kind of relation do you have with your body, your energy field? Very important, very significant. You think about all the psychosomatic conditions that we deal with and body image issues that we deal with. Relations with the family, I'm a member of this family, this group, this community, this society, this human being, I'm a human being. I'm a human being, that's what I say. The places. I'm from this place. This is my home place. This is a place of vision, place of refuge. Think about all the refugees who say, my home place is a place I have to flee from because it's war. I once heard a Palestinian say that all my life from childhood on, the place where I lived, I've known nothing but terror. Think about what that would do to a person. How that would shape their identity, you see? And then, more cosmically, the place on the earth. What is my relationship to the earth? What is my relationship to the universe? Einstein reputedly once said, one of the basic questions we have to figure out, is the universe friendly for me? I'm going to skip the next one and just go on to this one as the last.
The answer to that?
What? Did he?
Do you feel the universe is friendly to you?
Do I personally think the universe is friendly? No, I don't think so. I don't think the universe is concerned about me in that way. But I feel okay about being in the universe. I feel perfectly fine about the universe. I no longer have any question about it. I do have questions about it, but not in relationship to my place in it. Yes, my place in it too. Okay, so this is what I'll end with, and then we can discuss. This is a statement from Heraclitus in the upper line that I like very much. When we are asleep, we each live in our own world. When we are awake, we all live in the one great world. So here's my transcription of that. In the ordinary state of consciousness, we each live in the personal reality of our own worldview. When we awaken to higher consciousness, we become aware of our place in the greater, all-encompassing cosmos. So we can move into questions. That's the meaning. And we ask the question for meaning is a very interesting and beautiful and deep question. You know, to ask what is the meaning of an experience that you're having? Not what is the explanation of it. Let's say you have a drug experience, you take LSD, or let's say you fall in love. What is the meaning of that experience that you're having? Do you see how that goes? It kind of goes deeper. It is not necessarily that you'll be able to answer that question. There are some questions that are like that, that are not really meant to be answered. Because when you answer it, you realize it's like a Zen thing, you know? It's like a Zen thing. You don't really answer that question. You just keep asking it. If you answer it, then the Zen master says, you know, no, that's not it. Go back. Meditate some more. There was somebody else who had a question. Somebody had their hand up. Did you forget? I see. Oh, well, that's good. No, I don't know. Is that good? Yeah, you had another question.
Well, just to add to what you're, again, outlining, don't you think basically it opens the door immediately to intimacy? And because we live in a society that has been so dysfunctional for so long, right, people are afraid of that.
Right.
If I step out of the fear factor and say, well, what's the worst that can happen? Somebody could kill me. I mean, I think all these great leaders, whether it was Martin Luther King or Gandhi, they integrated that right away. They knew what the possibilities were.
On the other hand, yeah, and then when you're relating to other people, it definitely helps to take into account the state of consciousness that other people may be in that you're talking with, as well as your own, you see. Well, you start with your own. How can you possibly assess somebody else's state of consciousness if you're not aware of your own state of consciousness? So that's why the Buddhists recommend a balance of compassion and equanimity. See, equanimity means, it comes from two words, animus and equal. It means even-heartedness. It's a very beautiful concept. It means neither for nor against, nor away from. Not for, not against, and not away from. Even-hearted. Compassion. But not distance. There is a kind of equanimity that's cold. The detachment, the equanimity of detachment. That's different. That's why the Buddhists always say not just equanimity, but compassion as well. I mean, compassion means a little bit reaching out. Stay balanced. If you have the balance without the compassion, you tend to be cold, detached, cold. You know, I don't give a shit. Why should I care about your problems? If you have, it's also possible to have too much compassion without balance. The people that give so much of themselves and don't, wait a minute. So I actually think that Mother Teresa, who's widely admired as a great saint, she was on that pole. She didn't have balance. She couldn't receive for herself. She couldn't receive for herself. She was always giving to everybody else. She was a miserable woman. She confessed to that later on. She said, I'm such a miserable sinner. She never experienced, the way she put it, she never experienced God's grace. And she did so much for other people. But she was blocked on receiving for herself. Yes.
A little bit of a lead-in is something that I wanted to ask you about. There's a few of us who are here who practice something called integral transformative practice, which comes out of Michael Murphy's work and George Leonard's work. And so, of Michael Murphy's work of asking for connection and George Leonard. Mm-hmm. So, when we do our practice, we tend toward embodiment. We lean toward that, and we do it partly to have balance. What you hinted at with your comment about Mother Teresa had to do with the question of balance. Do you have anything to say about the role of embodiment? These are all models, sort of conceptual notions, but the role of embodiment in your own experience, in your experience as a psychologist, just working with other people, because it's possible to live quite up here really not really maybe have as much of a human life.
So
I'm interested in that question.
Yeah. Well, remember that, you know, we're talking about at the beginning of the four strands of awareness. And so embodiment, of course, we are embodied. After all, we have bodies, right? We say we have bodies. We are embodied spirits. That's what we are. And so to, you know, have our spiritual practice be something that doesn't recognize that is insane. It's not true. It can't possibly lead to good results. It's the detachment, you know. And there are forms of meditation which go in that direction. Transcendental meditation, for example, goes in that direction. You just focus on a mantra. And transcendence means going beyond the body, going beyond mind, going beyond the thought, just focusing on the mantra. And that's definitely a practice that people do, and that has a place, you know. I lean more to those spiritual traditions. There's all spiritual traditions, sometimes associated with Tantra, sometimes associated with Taoism, different people like Gurdjieff and others, and where the practice is holistic and works on all levels, mental, emotional, physical, perceptual, and spiritual, of course. And spiritual really transcends all the levels and embodies, you know, is inherent, intrinsic to all the levels. So, yes, it's a good thing, definitely. And, yes.
Given our collective experience of the past week and, you know, pro, con, yes, no, right, wrong, for the political scene, and this context in which you're speaking, and the one referred just with the last discussion of Mother Teresa, what and how can we find some common ground when there is such disparity, and there's so many other little nuances of how that disparity split us into many pieces, it seems. Mm-hmm. What would you suggest that we might do, other than just as an individual, of course, we have that right, I assume.
Yeah.
But collectively on a bigger scale, because it's not, you know, this is a wonderful group to have this carry this forth, but, you know, we're close to, 3.5 million people, and the rest of the world is watching us so carefully, and I feel compassion for them.
Yeah.
What would you suggest?
Well, thank you. You honor me more than I'm worth. If I have a suggestion, but this is the situation in which we find ourselves.
Yes.
And what one thing that this situation says is like loud and clear: get involved. Do not stay detached. Do not wait for somebody else to change the situation. It's not happening. So get together with other people. Talk about what to do at every level, in your family, in your community, in your society, in your job, like that.
Mm-hmm.
That would be my first step.
At what level do what? Because, like, let's say, Siddhartha Gautama, better known as Buddha, his father had intention for him to be king, right? And what did he do? He severed all his relationship with a very promising career to do what? To become a beggar, right?
No, not to become a beggar. That was just the first step.
Yeah, okay, but he lived
the life. Yeah, that was part of the practice. He wanted to experience what it's like as a beggar, not having, you know, having the opposite of riches. He had the riches, and then he said, "Well, I want to experience what is life like when I don't have that."
But he cut all, you know, like you talk about the selfless relationship. He cut all his relationships.
Yeah, he developed other relationships. He changed his life. He didn't change the fact that his father was his father or his mother was his mother. He changed those relationships. He went back to his mother. He went back to his father, and said, "You know, this is the kind of life I want to lead. Will you bless me?" That was always a traditional thing. The son wants to get the blessings of the father. The father initially didn't agree and said, "No, you're nothing but a beggar and miserable." But then afterwards he became his disciple. So did his mother. His mother and father became his disciples. And his brother. And his ex-wife. Not that everybody has to follow that path, but that was his
path. If he wouldn't have succeeded in his quest, then he wouldn't have become a disciple.
Yes,
I mean, he took a chance, right?
Yeah, of course, right, he took a chance. Each of us is taking a chance in life, every moment. Every moment we're taking a chance, aren't we? Every single moment. You took a chance in coming here, which I'm really grateful
for.
Thank you. Thank you, you took a chance. And maybe something, you know, something that came up will trigger something in you that is positive for you, I hope so.
Well,
there's a question over there. Can I answer that one? Respond to that one? Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Ralph, very much. I was coming here in the car, and the radio was NPR, and there was an interview with a man who started a company called Patagonia, and he spent many of his years mountain climbing. He even had a near-death experience in an avalanche and stuff, and he was talking about it. He said, he was talking about the definition of adventure. Mm-hmm. And he says, you know, he doesn't believe that really, people don't understand, adventure isn't really what they think, because it always requires more than a challenge, a threat to your life. To make it a real adventure, it has to be something surprising. You should leave out some of the things you think you will enjoy on your vacation to have an actual adventure trying to cope. So I thought about that, and just in relation to this question, you know, a lot of people take LSD or some other psychedelic, usually younger, idealistic type people are the ones that most interested in this. But it's such an easy and convenient thing because they can take it and then they know they have to go to work or school and they just have it and it's kind of almost like a little vacation. It's convenient. I'm wondering, you know, I'm thinking, what is the value of the experience when it's so convenient? You know what I mean? I mean, if you don't have to struggle and there's no challenge that you, no problem to solve, just sort of like fun, how much value can you really get from something when you don't sort of earn it in life compared to taking it on a whim, like a vacation or something.
That's a very widespread view. You know, you have to suffer in order to be saved. I don't know whether that's true or not. It's an attitude. It's a very widespread attitude. How would I know? I mean, how would I know whether that's always true? You see, I can't say. And of course,
you know without asking.
Yes, that's right. And people take drugs for all kinds of reasons.
Yeah.
And some of them have to do, I mean, the drugs called, I actually now don't prefer not to use the term psychedelic anymore, because psychedelic has now got sort of pop culture associations. I'll give you an example. One day, my daughter, when she was 9 years old, she came home from school and said, oh, look at those patterns, very psychedelic. What she was talking about was paisley patterns, you know, on a fabric. And, you know, I didn't have the heart to tell her, well, or the ability to explain to her, that's not what the essence of a psychedelic experience is all about. Paisley patterns, that's not it. Although, from the point of view of pop culture, yes.
That's a good example, because that's a visual. She was talking about a visual.
Yes, exactly. It's one aspect. But in my writings, what I've done is I look at I like the older term consciousness expanding.
Yeah.
Because psychedelic is a neologism. Neologism, a new word. People don't know what it means. They think they know what it means. But consciousness expanding are two ordinary words, and they're not often put together. You know, so a typical reaction might be consciousness can expand.
Yeah.
Who knew? my father, who was a very conservative German businessman, and I've talked to him about these things, and of course he didn't take any of these drugs, unlike my mother who did. But my father said, I liked his line, he said, I don't want to expand my consciousness. I have enough trouble dealing with my consciousness the way it is. Expanding it would just lead to more trouble. And that was perfectly true for him, you see. That was true for him. And people, if you feel that way, you definitely shouldn't. That was wise for him not to do that, because he would have had a hard time expanding your consciousness. You have to really want to do it, and then do it in a certain way. And just taking the drug isn't going to do it. I mean, people take LSD for all kinds of insane reasons, including bad reasons, criminal reasons. The CIA took it and gave it to people unbeknownst to themselves in order to brainwash people. Charlie Manson gave it to his people in order to commit mass murder and put them into that kind of a state. And so, you know, there's nothing inherently good or valuable about the drug. It's simply a means expanding awareness and perception. And what's the key is what's the intention? What are you doing with that experience? And you could do nothing with it, just, you know. So in my writings, I don't address recreational use. I'm not against recreational use, because why should I be against it? It's none of my business what people do for their recreation. And people who are taking acid or any other drugs for recreational use, as long as they're taking it themselves and not doing stupid, harmful things to other people or giving it to other people, I stay out of it. I might take it recreationally myself sometimes, but that's different from, I'm interested in when the potential of these substances for the use in healing, physical healing and psychological healing, spiritual practice, you know, expanding of awareness, with spiritual practice and visioning, and like that. Creativity and creativity enhancement. So enhancement of creativity, enhancement of spiritual practice, and spiritual awareness.
Forgive me for calling it the good old days, but we had set and setting.
Well, that's right, set and setting. But I now, you know, use the other formula, the intention or question, and then the substance, and then the consequence afterwards, the integration. Yes?
Since Timothy Leary and Richard Alpert have been gone, have you ever kind of...
Alpert isn't gone.
Well, no, but he's... His heart, he's had a pretty bad heart attack, though, and stuff, right?
Died?
Richard Albert. I'm not sure if he died.
No.
Ron Doss.
Yeah.
That's Ron Doss.
Yeah.
Ron Doss.
Anyways.
But he's still with us.
Okay, so have you ever, like, heard anything from Leary, like, from the other side?
And then, heard anything from Leary from the other side?
Yeah. It's kind of out there question, but...
A long time ago. Not recently. Yeah. I had a dream that he was sitting on top of a house that was burning down, and he waved at me. He was not worried. He had the most positive attitude of any man I've ever known, and he was relentlessly positive, authentically so, and. he just didn't allow himself to be caught up in negative experiences, including when he was actually experiencing extremely negative things that almost anybody else would be, you know. Plus, he was completely detached, you know, from things, images of reputation. He didn't give a shit about his reputation at all. He thought it was a joke. You know, and you know, he said, "Who was the guy that who was district? He was district attorney, not district attorney, attorney general of the United States."
Oh yeah.
Well, who was that in the? Well, Nixon, the president of the United States. He said that is the most dangerous man alive. And Leary was asked, well, what do you think of that? And he said, yes, it's true. I have America surrounded. So that was his attitude. You know? He said, you know, life is given to us. It's an adventure, and we should have fun doing it. He did not, I don't agree with the people that he had a destructive, self-destructive plan. Not at all. Not at all. He didn't want to go to jail. He went to jail because he was reckless. He thought the interest of what he was doing was more important than his own safety. So he was reckless in regard to his own safety. And that was kind of scary. It's kind of scary to me. And that's why I kind of disconnected from him, because I began to be afraid of my safety when I was around him. And I had a couple of close experiences where one time when I was spending the weekend with him, my girlfriend and I spent the weekend with him at this retreat in Southern California, and then he was going to go back to Orange County where he had a group of followers, and they were there after the weekend, and we were thinking of going back with him, but then my girlfriend got slightly sick, so I decided, no, we should leave. And on that drive back down, he got busted again, you know, for the third time or fourth time in Orange County, and again faced another 10 years in jail. And if I'd been with him, I could have been caught up in that thing. So in some way, kind of my guiding spirits kind of protected me and said, I don't need to go into that part of his karma. You know, we did our karma, we did our task together. It lasted for about 5-6 years of very close collaboration, the three of us, and no regrets, no regrets, no blame, and appreciation, gratefulness. If he has a terrible reputation, but I think that's going to change, and I think in the next generation or so, maybe it'll take 100 years or so, I think his reputation, he'll be seen as differently too. Because all the things that people say to him, he gave all these dangerous drugs to people, he sold all these drugs. Not true, he didn't sell any drugs. People gave him drugs, you know, he didn't need to sell any drugs. He was associated with drug sellers, dealers, and he never gave a drug to a person who didn't want it. Absolutely not. That was one of the key principles of the ethics. You know, you don't expand somebody else's consciousness. Don't give somebody else a drug without their knowledge. It's common sense, you know, and without, you know, informed consent, absolutely. So, anyway, he's a great
friend. You feel good about MAPS?
MAPS, what? Yeah, the MAPS organization?
Yeah.
Yes, the MAPS organization is a wonderful organization that's dedicated to changing the drug laws. Mm-hmm. And in relationship to these particular drugs. I think actually, I also like the Drug Policy Alliance, which is dedicated to changing the drug laws in the wider context, including counteracting the persecution of drug addicts and imprisonment of drug addicts and all kinds of different things, and the more general political thing. I think we all need to get involved, and that's the message of Trump again. We all need to get involved. We can't wait for somebody else to do it. Somebody else is not going to do it. I mean, somebody else is going to do something, but not what you can do in your community. And it doesn't have to be alone. Of course, none of us is alone. All of us live in a community of other people. And believe me, I know for a fact. I grew up in Germany, and I was a kid, but then in the aftermath of the Second World War, people got together and said, like, now that we've, you know, we're in this traumatic situation. People were dying like flies. People were dying in their apartments at night because they didn't have coal to heat their houses. They were just dying of cold, not of war or crime or anything. And so all the people then get together and like support one another. And that can happen again, and it needs to happen, because the situation we're in is grim beyond belief. It is really grim beyond belief. But we're human beings, and human beings have a history of being able to rise to the challenge and do what we can. So should we maybe end at this point? How are we doing for time? It's 9. Thank you.